Welcome. It's just gone 7 p.m. Wednesday, the 1st of September, and you are watching episode 21 of Regional Wrap. Regional Wrap, providing an insight into the issues affecting regional Australia and giving a voice to regional residents. My name is Bill Bates. Joining me in this episode, how many levels of government is too much, and is there room for new states? Is my guest, Professor AJ Brown, leader of the Centre of Governments and Public Policy, Public Integrity and Anti-Corruption Research Program, and is the Professor of Public Policy Law in the School of Government and International Relations at Griffith University. He's one of Australia's top constitutional experts focusing on public integrity, accountability and performance of the Australian federal system, especially for the regions, states and local communities. Professor Brown founded the Australian Constitution Value Survey and in 2012 was a member of the Commonwealth Government's Expert Panel on Constitutional Recognition of Local Government. Since 2010, he has been a board member of Transparency International Australia, World Anti-Corruption Organisation. In 2017, and again in 2020, was elected to the Transparency International's Global Board, where he led the development of its worldwide strategy, holding power to account. A testament to his passionate advocacy and effectiveness and responsive and accountable government. Welcome, Professor Brown.
Thanks very much, Bill. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Thank you for joining us in this episode. I'd like to start in regards to your real passion in regards to accountable governments and anti-corruption, and talk about, well, at least the two bodies in the states of New South Wales and Queensland. But I also understand there's a lot of discussion now about having a federal equivalent to ICAC. So I'll just share a screen. In New South Wales, we've got ICAC, which was established in 1988. And in Queensland, we have the CCC, which was is a merger between the old Crime and Corruption Commission, Crime and Misconduct Commission, and the former Justice Commission. The merger was in 2002, and we ended up with the CCC. Now, one of the things about these anti-corruption people is they do have very extensive powers, and while we are trying to hold government and public service people to account, politicians, sometimes there seems to be a bit of overreach by these bodies in regards to there doesn't seem to be any protection for people who come under their investigations and who may actually not have done anything wrong, but they certainly get tarred in the first instance.
You know, I mean, it's great to open on the theme of accountability, Bill, because especially at the present time, you know, we're really reliant on making sure that all our governments are doing the right thing by the people, and accountability is the core of that. I guess that's why it's really important that we have strong integrity and accountability bodies, you know, in any jurisdiction, whether it's at a state level or a federal level. And my personal view is that in fact, every state and territory in Australia has now got an anti-corruption body like that, like the Crime and Corruption Commission here in Queensland, but they do vary a bit, and the accountability of them does vary a bit as well. I guess the thing to remember, I mean, I think on the whole that they are pretty accountable. At the moment in Queensland, the Parliamentary Committee on the Parliamentary Crime and Corruption Committee is actually holding a pretty powerful high-level review of some of the Crime and Corruption Commission's activities in response to complaints from concerned organisations and citizens. There's also a parliamentary inspector who monitors what that commission does, and there's similar arrangements in other states. And I think things can go wrong, and it really is important to be vigilant that any kind of investigative body or law enforcement body isn't out of control. But I think for the most part, the checks and balances are pretty good, and they are really, really important. And I think that the fact that citizens can complain to the parliamentary inspector, they can complain to the Parliamentary Crime and Corruption Committee. Democracy is still in charge of what any of these agencies do. I think that that's really important. Those are really important principles. And then the other thing I think that's worth remembering with them is that wherever possible, you know, if we're talking about misconduct that's criminal or a breach of the law, then it will end up and should end up back with the courts with all the normal protections of due process and the rule of law. And that's what happens. And that's what happened in some of the cases we're talking about in Queensland now with investigations into local government. So I think it's a very good question. On the whole, I actually think, as somebody who looks at this very closely, that you know, there's always ways to improve it, but that we strike a pretty good balance with the models that we've got at state level in Australia so far, on the whole.
I think in some instances, but the character of some of the people presenting the complaint in the first place is sometimes a bit dubious. Is there sort of criteria that those commissions take in regards to, well, if person's either can be a vexatious litigant or complainer, or their character could be motivated by something else? Is there a reasonable amount of check in regards to substance of what and the people who complain?
Yeah, no, in my experience, there definitely is. I mean, when I worked in the Commonwealth Government a long time ago, I had this kind of job myself. And a lot of my research now is specifically looking at whistleblowing and whistleblowers and who they are and what happens to them and just how important they are. So, we've got to remember that sometimes it's unrealistic to expect people who speak up about wrongdoing or even criminal wrongdoing or corruption or whatever to necessarily be pure as the driven snow themselves. And often there'll be conflict inside organisations or inside government or public service or whatever that will contribute to people blowing the whistle and flushing out their concerns. But what the research shows and what the track record of these integrity agencies shows is that just like the police, in fact, you know, these integrity agencies are pretty savvy. They don't jump at every shadow. They test stuff. They check it out. They don't believe everybody, the first time around. So there's some pretty strong filters against people who would abuse the system. Certainly, there's no tolerance, just like there isn't any tolerance from the police, or shouldn't be. There's no tolerance from these types of integrity agencies for people who provide false or misleading information. And to the extent that people might blow the whistle based on conflicts and other motives, very often we've got to recognise that that information is still really vital for flushing out what's really going on and often for flushing out wrongdoing, which is far worse than the particular conflict or grievance that might have triggered a person to blow the whistle. So I think it's really important for people to recognise that it doesn't matter where you work, doesn't matter what you do, what sort of institution you work in or what sort of employer you have, things do go wrong. Some people do the wrong thing, and we really are reliant on people speaking up about it, whether they've got mixed motives or not, in order to make sure that wrongdoing is addressed. And I think we have to, again, there's what, you know, we have to make sure the protections are there in the system, and I think generally they are, that people can't abuse the system and their right to complain. But really, we rely as a democracy And for healthy organisations, we rely on the right of people to be able to speak up about their concerns. And inside organisations and inside institutions, local government, whichever, whatever, that's actually vital. And we know that in Australia and we know that worldwide, and they're very important and precious rights that we've got to protect if we want to have healthy democracy and accountable institutions.
In Queensland, a lot of the focus has been on local government. I'm not too sure how many cases in regards to state politicians. I don't think there's actually been too many of, a serious nature where involved, gaining benefits of that. But in the council level, that seems to be, we seems to have had a run of them over the last 3 years or so, from down in Toowoomba. I think even our Cairns council is now under scrutiny. And I think there's been a number of other ones along the coast. Not so much the ones inland. I don't know what that is. Maybe they haven't got the time to get up to mischief, or there's not enough people to sort of encourage them to do misdeeds in development of that, or there's no development in inland Queensland. But it definitely seems to be prevalent in the down in the busier sort of southeast corner, bigger councils, and some up the coast sort of thing. So there again, some of them have yielded prison sentences out of those investigations, and I think some people have been sort of exonerated as well. So there's a bit of a mixture there. Can you recount any sort of any high profile cases in the state sphere, because I haven't heard of a state politician being convicted actually or anything like that.
Yeah, no, absolutely there are. I mean, I think it pays to go back to the origins of these types of agencies in Queensland, but also in New South Wales and elsewhere. Well, which
you're
was
going really back into the 80s now, I think.
Well, yeah, the 80s and 90s, because in Queensland, we talk a lot about the Fitzgerald Inquiry in the late 1980s. That was that really did expose and deal with the extent to which state politics had, was in a corrupt state. Since then, there's been a number of really significant inquiries. I mean, it's a few years ago now, but during the BD Bligh government's, Gordon Nuttall, the Labor Minister, went to jail as a result of a Crime and Corruption Commission investigation into. So I think that state politicians generally are much more on alert. They're much more conscious now of the scrutiny. And even last year, in the last couple of years, the fate of Jackie Trad, the former Premier, was really resulted from the fact that even without it being shown to be the same type of corruption that Gordon Nuttall engaged in or the Bjelke-Petersen government was engaged in way back, the scrutiny is there, and even the appearance of conflicts of interest can be really damaging and can lead to the end of, effectively to the end of people's ministerial or parliamentary careers. I think what's really interesting, what you said, is this focus on local government that we've had in this area in Queensland in recent years. Many, many people would regard as having been quite long overdue, and we can see in other states, in Western Australia, in Victoria, in New South Wales, when the lid has been lifted on corruption risks in local government, there's been a lot that's been found, and I think that that's for reasons that really probably don't surprise people actually, and we should talk about some of those corruption risks, but also the lack
of very close community links.
Yeah, I mean maybe we can get onto that, but I think the key thing is that currently and recently in Queensland, there has been some much stronger focus. I think that in Southeast Queensland, the investigations into Ipswich City Council in particular. Again, you know, Labor-dominated council, but it's not, you know, obviously not restricted to Labor-dominated councils or situations. Far from it. The you know, there was long overdue to see a proper scrutiny and a proper clean out, and that's what effectively occurred due to the Crime and Corruption Commission's focus on some of those councils. And so I think at the moment we're seeing a little bit of a backlash from some areas of local government against that scrutiny, and I think that backlash is quite frankly probably on the whole a confirmation of the fact that the scrutiny was overdue. So if the result of all of this is that we find that in local government there's a much higher awareness, much higher consciousness of the scrutiny that is being applied, then I don't actually believe that that's a bad thing.
No, that's a good thing. But if we just move to New South Wales, and although it never got to ICAC situation, but something as menial as a gift of a bottle of wine brought down the Premier of New South Wales. Do you think that sort of thing is a bit of overreaction or something? I mean, it doesn't seem worthy of bringing down a Premier. I mean, if you do one thing sort of not by the rules, because he could have accepted and just actually all he had to do was you note it and then you can hand it into the keepers of the state wealth to go to auction or whatever they want to do with it. But that seems to me a small loss, a penalty for...
I think it's an interesting example. You're talking about Premier Barry O'Farrell there, who resigned after a hearing of the Independent Commission Against Corruption. He initially couldn't remember the fact that he'd received this very expensive wine, talking about hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands of dollars worth of one bottle as a gift from a lobbyist from a lobbyist. So then caught with the fact that he had accepted it and he couldn't remember it and he clearly should have remembered it. He chose to resign. In fact, that investigation didn't call for his resignation or anything, but he chose to resign because of the embarrassment of the fact that he didn't even remember that he'd received something as significant as that when clearly the evidence was that he had. It's not just like it was an average $25 bottle of wine, so I think what's really important is to remember that if a politician chooses to resign for that reason, then yes, it's a confirmation of the fact that the scrutiny itself is very powerful, and that scrutiny shouldn't be overexploited. But it's also an indicator that there's a backstory, there's more detail to this, and I think if you look at New South Wales politics in particular, and its history and the history of corruption in New South Wales, there are real, real deep problems in New South Wales politics with corruption risks. You've got to remember things like what's been exposed more recently about the role of Crown Casino, Crown Resorts, and not just in New South Wales, but in Victoria and Western Australia. Their responsibility for money laundering has now been confirmed. The prudence and the ethics of that organisation has been, you know, brought into question for good reason. And you've got to look back and remember it was Barry O'Farrell who facilitated effectively the sweetheart deal by which Crown Resorts got that property in Barangaroo in Sydney on which to build the Barangaroo Crown Casino Resort, with no public tender. So you've got to look back and say, you know, there's more to the story when something like that happens. Ultimately it was Premier Barry O'Farrell's decision to resign as a result of that information having been exposed. So again, I think the transparency and then the results sometimes speak for themselves.
maybe for those people who are thinking of becoming politicians at any level of government, maybe they need to go to as a prerequisite before they sign up as a, you know, log on as a candidate for any party. They have to view something in regards to what the integrity requirements are and shown what's happened to previous people. So you've got to make sure you have a good standard of integrity before you even contemplate stepping into that field.
I think that's true, but I also think that shouldn't deter, you know, good, fair-minded citizens who are just trying to do the right thing for their community. Because I think if our whole political system is populated by people who that's their intention and that's what they do at local government level, at state government level, at federal government level, and it's a really hard job being a politician at any level. And I think anybody who does it needs to be ready to face up to the scrutiny and the transparency that they need to show. But I don't, you know, I really hope that, and certainly I believe the safeguards should be there to make sure that scrutiny and that need for transparency doesn't deter people from doing it, because certainly that's what we rely on. And we're a very, very lucky country in that we might talk about the level of corruption and accountability is really, really important, but it's partly because we're talking about accountability and it's partly because of the vigilance of the community and these agencies that we end up with what is, generally speaking, compared to many, many countries in the world, pretty high quality government and a pretty low level of corruption on the whole. We've got to be careful we keep it that way, because it slips away very easily. But certainly we should remember that, I think, when we think about our decision makers and our politicians in particular.
Okay, we'll move on now. The reason I originally got in contact with you was because I saw a late line video, it was up on YouTube, yourself, Jason Murphy, the economist, and Robbie Katter. And one of the things you brought up in regards to the states are basically bankrupt, and Jason didn't sort of actually agree with that. He was sort of emphasising he, as an economist, saw the ability to service those debts and that as at that time. With there again, we're talking about 2016. He considered them manageable. Robbie didn't have much of a position on that. But if we could just talk about what is now ballooning debt, and it was heading that way before COVID, but now it really is turning into a bit of a monster. And whether we can service those debts in the long term, especially if we're using borrowed money to pay for day-to-day running of government, because there's a difference between what most people call good and bad debt. I mean, if you're borrowing money just to run your day-to-day expenses, like in your own household, you're borrowing money to pay the butcher, the baker, and the candlestick maker, you're in trouble. If you're borrowing for an investment house or something like that, that's going to earn you income and help you secure your future in retirement things, that's typically what we'd class as good debt. And that's the same with governments. If they'd spend a reasonable sort of amount of money on infrastructure that actually grows the pie, that's something reasonable. But if they're only just borrowing money to pay for hospitals that they're currently using, or even borrowing money for Cross River rail tunnels, where it's not an asset, things are liability, it's something you've got to maintain for years and years to come. It's going to cost you to maintain an under river tunnel. It's going to cost you hundreds of millions of dollars a year just in maintenance and keeping it in condition, let alone paying the debt and then getting enough revenue off the people who are using the tunnel. But my understanding with the Cross River tunnel, it's only a rail tunnel. Now, that is an absolute bad deal, because every public transport journey is subsidised, roughly in Queensland, in southeast Queensland, and especially in Brisbane. It's effectively $11 of taxpayers' money for every journey taking on public transport. That's the huge cost of running the public transport network. So it's not something that's going to grow the pie. Whereas if you spend $5 or $6 billion on putting a new dam that opens up new farmland, or you put up a road infrastructure that costs you $1 billion, but it opens up a new mining area or some other productive area, that's growing the pie. So there's good and bad there. Do you agree with that?
Well, I think it's really important to think, when we think about what structure of government we want, to remember a couple of things. One is that there's indirect benefits, as opposed to simply direct benefits, and that also in this pandemic, post-pandemic environment, the rule book has really, changed very substantially in terms of what we would expect, or what our objectives were as governments in Australia. And around the world, in terms of levels of debt that we want to carry. What government as a whole in Australia has clearly done is said, well, we're happy to borrow heavily and invest heavily in public health and the security of public health, which is a very intangible, in many ways, quite indirect benefit. And I think everybody is happy about that, because the consequences alternatively would be have been to set ourselves back. I think the economic payoff for that is already manifesting. I think the other key thing we've got to remember in terms of infrastructure, and again, this gets us back especially to what's good and best for local and regional communities in particular, is that we've, as a nation, we've underinvested in infrastructure, all sorts of basic infrastructure, for quite a long time. So if we want to position ourselves for sustainability and livability for the long term, we have to seriously think about investment in infrastructure. The Inland Rail Network is an element of that. And I think when it comes to cities like Brisbane and the costs of urban transport infrastructure, the indirect benefits are of keeping cities livable and sustainable are really very fundamental still, even though, especially in a COVID environment, a lot of people are getting out of cities, and that's a good thing. But I think the indirect benefits of that are pretty clear. I think it's really interesting how the mayors of Southeast Queensland sort of led the charge in the end on the Southeast Queensland Olympics bid, specifically because they would see that it was the road to getting federal and state investment in infrastructure, which otherwise wasn't going to happen, which is otherwise going to mean that what can be one of the most livable sort of larger metropolitan areas in the world, and currently is, will cease to be that without that type of infrastructure. And it'll become a California and a blight on the landscape of the world unless it's properly, unless that infrastructure is there. So the Olympics are a tactic for getting that infrastructure, and I think that shows some savviness on the part of the mayors of Southeast Queensland.
That's fine for them, but it doesn't do anything for regional Australia and the underinvestment in regions. I mean, which has been going on for a long time. So we'll approach that a little bit later. If I just can share a couple of screens in regards to what the debt and forecast debt are, so people got an appreciation where we are and where we're going. This is an indication from, this is just the ABC, and it's just a run up in regards to our debt by June 2022 in the federal sphere is going to be $963 billion, which is 45% of GDP, and it's going to increase to $1.199 trillion, or $1,199 billion, by June 2025, which will be 50%. So the Commonwealth has been has carried all the weight through this pandemic with writing the states a blank check. Victoria's its debts increased from 86 to 104, due to go up to 154 billion. New South Wales isn't doing too bad. 153 billion up to 104, and Queensland net debt 25 billion up to 50 billion. Now, I don't quite agree with those figures because there's different areas of debt in the state in regards to what the state has, the Treasury or the state government's got, and then there's also the debt that's farmed off to other entities over time. Like we've had a situation over the years, especially in the Bede Bligh era, of entities such as Sunwater, Ergon, Ports North, and other government facilities, which were surplus. But what the government did is took the surplus away and then gave them a debt to service. So Ergon went from having a surplus to having a $4 billion debt, which now the consumers service as part of keeping Ergon basically running. So there's a lot of debt that's sort of not in those figures there. But they appear manageable. I think it's probably interesting to look at the graph in regards to how it shifted over the years and where we were and where we're going to, which is more relevant and what we need to look at in the future. So I'll just give that a share. This is a net debt for the whole nation, Australia's net public debt. And you can see the era where we came out of the Hawke Keating government. We got back into surplus under the Howard government, actually building surpluses. And then, of course, we thought it was a good time, seeing we had good management of the money, we'd change things and change the government to a Rudd government. And off we went, and we've been going that way ever since with our net debt. So, and that's a theme all the way through. And this is the situation at the moment with in orange is local government debt, which we hardly ever had before, but we've got some now. State debts were almost missing in the sort of before the change of millennium. But they've picked up, but it's really the Commonwealth government that's carrying the bulk of debt. So now Jason would contend that we can still manage that and service it. Do you still have reservations that we're basically bankrupt or we need to really rein in those types of expenditures? Or it's just something we've just got to live with?
Well, I think, I mean, I'm not an economist, so you probably need to get an economist on for your next
region. No, it was just that you, in that conversation, you did point out, yeah. you thought we're putting on the bankruptcy side, and Jason said no, but I just wonder if you had time to sort of review that position or over time. You think it's something we have to
do? Yeah, well, I think it's a very good question to ask. I think we need to see where we land as we really properly get to the end of this phase of the pandemic, and weigh up the pros and cons, and then figure out how we're going to get back to something that we're comfortable with. I think you're right in pointing out. I don't think the Commonwealth. This is sort of getting back to the structure of the Federation, really. I don't think the Commonwealth is giving the states a blank check. I think the Commonwealth is carrying a lot of expenditure. But I think what is really interesting is that the federal government is actually relying on the states to do an enormous amount of work at the moment that many people in the country would think was possibly a federal responsibility, or that the federal government perhaps should be more involved in. So I think this whole period is going to end up with us wanting to look again at the way that the finances are structured within the Federation. In terms of the overall picture of how much debt we're prepared to carry, again, I think that's a calculation that's been made. You've got to remember that back in 2007, 2008, when we were in a more positive position, the global financial crisis hit and required quite a lot of intervention and stimulus that then was sort of the beginning of this modern phase, and the pandemic is simply a whole other level again of that same need to have greater financial flexibility as a nation in a very turbulent, very turbulent world. So I think what this is going to do is make us look at how we can best allocate the resources within the Federation to remain sustainable, but to actually, the big issue is still who's responsible for what and have they got the resources that they need to do it. And I think the pandemic is laying that fairly bare as well, which might bring us back to local and regional concerns a bit more.
I think one of the interesting things is that I think through this pandemic, people have sort of become aware of the difference in powers of states versus federal, whereas that's something they never really saw in action before. If you go to the Constitution, it lays out separations of powers pretty well. Unfortunately, some of them have been corrupted over time by the federal government offering the state governments financial incentive to surrender certain things. We also had World War II, where we saw the states give up income tax powers to the federal government. Basically, it was supposed to be a short-term measure, emergency measure sort of thing, but somehow forgot to give it back. And I think it was fairly late, maybe sometime in the 50s. I think New South Wales actually tried to get them back, but they were shot down in the High Court. So I'm not 100% sure of that, but the way it is, that's the way it is. I don't believe that's going to change. There's probably things in the Constitution that probably could change. And I'm particularly like to see Section 95 go. I think that's been there lot longer than it was ever intended by the founding fathers, where the Commonwealth shores up the states. I think that's one section we probably should have a good look at. It's probably now time for the Parliament to decide otherwise. I think the term is if there's something in there that doesn't have to actually change by a referendum. And there are a lot of items in the Constitution you don't need a referendum on. It's simply if the Parliament otherwise decides, and they can take the action. So that's one thing. The other thing is, like you're talking about, we need to, when we do come out of the pandemic and we've got to invest, it's very critical that we invest in the right things. Like you mentioned the GFC and the need to pump money into the economy. Well, maybe people should go and revisit some of those programs they had. Absolutely disasters and never gave us any long-term benefit. They provide work for, and I still, for the unions and big companies in a lot of cases, like the school program for new canteen facilities, shade areas, play areas, and other modifications to school. Then there was the pink bats, which, this is the trouble what the government gets into half the time. It ends up getting rorted because they don't police it, or they don't set it up properly. That's just too rushed. I mean, if you ever remember the Pink Bats saga, there was heaps of people who came out from overseas, set up little companies and went around supposedly installing Pink Bats that actually never did. They just signed something with the owners and they split the difference sort of thing. And I think that was a problem. And then what happened, the fallout for that was the insulation industry was completely decimated as a result of that going into the future. But there's lessons to be learned if we choose to look at history and that. And I hope when they come to fixing up after COVID, they do look at all those sort of what programs actually provided the long-term benefit and really provided relief. So I think that's essential. But I would hope we get something more for our money than we got out of the GFC situation.
Well, I think it's really interesting to think about some of those examples. The Pinkbacks home insulation program is a good example where I think the Commonwealth government did learn its lesson that it's not necessarily the right level of government to deliver that sort of program. They were trying to find and the key thing about COVID is the COVID response is that things have been done very differently. Something like the home builder program, the injection, Commonwealth injection of funds into home building has been run through the states rather than the Commonwealth dishing out the money directly. And similarly, the Commonwealth is relying on the states a lot more in the COVID response than in the GFC response, for example. And partly that is a confirmation of why we need to be a structure of government, the federation, where government is close to the people. The problem with our federation, of course, is that state governments often aren't as close to the people as they should be, but they're still quite a lot closer than the federal government is. So they have that much benefit from the federation, but especially in Queensland, but also even in New South Wales, you can see how the dominance of Sydney and the thinking about how to manage Sydney has left other regions of New South Wales at a big disadvantage. And that is the long-term history of the scale of the states that we have in Australia, which has particularly affected New South Wales and Queensland, and then the others to a lesser degree because their population is either they're not so huge or their population isn't so huge. Mm-hmm. So I think there's some really big lessons. Some of them are positive that the states have actually proven why it makes sense to have strong state governments, and they've got stronger in some respects as a result of the recognition of their responsibility for public health and the fact that the Commonwealth could just not do it, couldn't do it responsibly and reactively. And I think we need to remember that we've benefited from the fact that states have been quite autonomous in their decision-making and gone out alone and taken the lead and made the hard decision to lock things down when if the Commonwealth government had been in charge of all of that, I really don't think that we could say that we would have made the same decisions that in hindsight were wise that we in fact made. I mean, you've got to remember back at the beginning of the pandemic when the Prime Minister was going off to the football match, to the NRL final, at the same time as saying that it's time to lock down. And then decided that was not a smart move or a smart message to send. But that was the tone of the decision making. Whereas it was state leaders whose public health professionals closer to the ground were saying, "No, we've got a tiny window of opportunity left to get on top of this, and we've got to take it right now." So things have moved on now, and it's a different set of decisions, but I think we've got to recognise those are some of the benefits of a federation. What we haven't, a couple of really interesting challenges is that what's been a standout is that the Commonwealth government is actually responsible under the constitution for quarantine, and yet it's been relying on the states very heavily to run and manage the nation's quarantine system. I mean, I personally find that really surprising and difficult to understand. at the same time, we would have, so that's sort of one area where the federation appears to have still been.
But I think in regards to quarantine, where that feds come into it is people coming into the country, not people in their own state that become infected and have to go to quarantine. The Commonwealth Northern Territory set up a system there to bring back people and that, which was basically all funded and backed by the Commonwealth. Admittedly, there was Northern Territory play in that, but even that
Commonwealth investment in the Howard Springs type infrastructure is only a fraction of what the states have been carrying through the hotel quarantine systems that hang off the major international airports, for example. And I think it contrasts very, very significantly to history when the Commonwealth played a much greater role in managing maritime quarantine services, for example. So there's a whole, it's really interesting to think about, well, what role do we want the Commonwealth to be playing in managing and funding quarantine and biosecurity, and what role is it playing? I'm not saying that it's playing no role, or that it's, that it should play the whole role, but I think it's a really important area to be looking at, to be thinking about, well, is everybody playing the role that we would want them to play? On the other hand, I think at a state level, especially the biggest states, I think we can say that if there were stronger regional arrangements for managing public health that were more autonomous, we might be even better off than we are. In Queensland and then Victoria, we've seen the most regional variation in the public health response. Queensland was the first place to say, well, no, we're going to be selective in where we lock down, and we're going to apply differential rules to outside the southeast corner, and the distance rules for how far you could travel once restrictions started to be lifted after the national lockdown last year. Queensland, there should have been and should be more variation, but at least it was the state where some of that variation, that need for variation, was acknowledged. And I'm on the Queensland New South Wales border, so I can see how they're wrestling with the need to manage variation, border bubbles and bubbles in general. I think the big question is whether we would be better off if we had, or how we would be better off if we could have a federal system where some of these things were controlled at a more, even more regional level than they currently are. In New South Wales, I remember not that long ago, the Hunter District health chiefs saying they should have just blown up the bridge over the Hawkesbury River between Sydney and Newcastle. And they were quite seriously saying if we'd done that, it might have been the best thing. They would have preferred it if they could have had internal border closures within New South Wales to do the job properly. And I think in Queensland we can think the same thing. We can see that as COVID sweeps through, as we open up, we need to slow it down. And how are we going to slow it down? Well, we're going to have to think seriously about slowing it down through regional restrictions so that we have control, not because restrictions are a nice thing or that we want to have, but because our communities deserve to have a greater level of control over what's happening to them. And we're better off with the states on the whole than if we had no states, but we should be thinking about further decentralization of some of these functions and resources. I think
one of the things that COVID's also done is brought out some angst in regards to the regions versus the inner cities or the capital cities. New South Wales escaped for a fair sort of time before the restrictions hit regional New South Wales, but Victoria in particular, their regional people were absolutely livid that every time something happened in Melbourne, they were getting locked down, although there was no cases. And I think in regards to Queensland, I think it was pretty wise of Palaszczuk realising that there's a difference between Northern Queensland and Central Queensland and the southern areas of that. And I don't think for a while they did try the one rule fits all, and I think there was a lot of pushback against that. We had the distance restrictions, so you weren't allowed to travel more than 25 kilometers and that, but they all gradually disappeared. But I don't think you can actually have the one size fits all, especially if the prevalence of the COVID is just not there. It's like, the locking down and having social distance rules for places like Mount Isa, and there wasn't a case within 1,000 kilometres. That's lunacy, but it did happen. So it has brought some angst in regards to the difference between the people in the city around the capital city and their satellite cities versus people in regions. And the thing is, Our founding fathers actually gave us the mechanism to resolve this, and they gave us chapter six, create new states. So basically, as we developed areas away from our power base or the parliament of Sydney, Brisbane, and not so much Melbourne, because you can't get too far away in Victoria from there, but it provided the mechanism to create an additional state. So, and that was basically, well, it had to be put there because before Federation, Queensland almost didn't come into the Federation because at that time in the 1890s, we were in a state of just about warfare with Brisbane in regards to trying to create separate colonies of Central Queensland and North Queensland. And the 1890 petition that was drafted in Rockhampton and went through over to Britain and eventually got knocked back. But that was debated in the House for years in regards to the separation of the areas. And basically, the final thing that got Queensland over the line for joining the Federation was the agreement to have in Chapter 7 with regards to the Senate, Queensland, if it was a founding state, had the option to split the Senate into two divisions, like one for Southern Division, one for the Northern Division, with six. Well, at that stage, there was only six senators in the Federation for each state, founding state, in 1900. So there would have been three senators for the Southern region and three for Northern region, and they would have been elected by the relevant voters in those two areas. So we have got the mechanism, but we just haven't had the ability to get to that stage, although we came close in 67 when New South Wales actually had a referendum of a new state for New England. So it can be done, you know, it just didn't get over the line. But the other interesting thing is, It's also in an era in the late 20s and early 30s that New South Wales government actively looked at creating new states in New South Wales. They had the Cohen Commission in the mid-20s to late 20s. Then they followed that with the Nicholls Commission. The Cohen Commission was to identify areas that could become new states, and they basically, northeastern New South Wales, Riverina and Eden Monaro with three categories. And then the next thing with the Nicholls Commission came in was to look at, well, how do you separate these new areas? What's the criteria in that? And so they came out with a lot of things like, you know, the borders can't be along a river course and divide communities either side of the river. The border should go over sparsely populated areas. Water supply should be continuous through that region. And not cut off any other region. So they're actually engaged, but the two things happened. The Great Depression, so there was no real keenness to go forward with it. And of course, from there, we moved to World War II. And then after that, of course, well, we've basically got into the two-party system, and neither of those are too keen on the idea. And it was only the fact that the New England New State movement had influence on the then Country Party that actually got them to support it. And as a minor party, brokered the deal with Askin, if they won the 65 election, that they would give the people in New England a referendum. So we have got the mechanism there. So in regards to the level of governments, people currently say we've got too many, but how many have we really got? I've got my opinion. I'd just like to hear what your take on the current level of governments that we have, and what do you feel is an optimum?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think you're quite right in the bulk of your history there, Bill, because there's no question that the expectation that Queensland should be three states was the reason why Queensland joined the Federation. We know that people in North Queensland and Central Queensland voted to join the Federation in 1898, because they believed that chapter of the Constitution would work and would enable them to be admitted as their own states. Whereas in Southeast Queensland, that the vote was the other way. And we, for various reasons, we know that that's why Queensland ended up entering the Federation, and a similar thing occurred in Western Australia. But the key thing that some people realised, but not everybody, was that by then the constitution had been drafted so that the existing state parliament had a veto power over that state separation trigger being being pulled, and there was no way around that veto. So the real difficulty about that is, I mean, I think Australia would benefit as an alternative to the current system. I think we would benefit from having a few more states for sure than we've currently got. We wouldn't solve all our problems, but I think we'd be better off than having the very large centralised states we've got, particularly New South Wales and Queensland, are still a big problem. But I think the key thing is that it doesn't matter how many states we have to be a more cooperative federal system than we are, and there has to be more understanding and agreement between the levels about what their roles are and sharing of resources to do those roles properly. And that would be a problem that would be worse if we had more states than it is today. So we've got to fix the systems of cooperative federalism so that we work better as a federation. And what's really interesting to me, though, is that when we do a lot of our research through the Constitutional Values Survey, we pick up a lot of support for having regional governments in addition to the current states and local government, having a four-tiered system. So, I mean, some people think the answer is to abolish the states. We don't need them. Not less people think that now, especially after COVID, than before. And that would really be a very simplistic answer to a much more complex problem than we've got. What's really interesting is that a lot of people, especially in places like Central Western Queensland or East Gippsland or wherever, think that actually having a strong regional government, in addition to having small, really small local government and having state governments as they currently are, would be a better system, that four tiers would be better than two and better than three. And I think, mm-hmm. I think that's worth reflecting on, because it shows that people know that there's a gap in the system in terms of regional level capacity and authority, but that the way to fill that gap and build up that stronger regional government is not necessarily to do away with the levels that we've currently got. So I think that that's a really interesting thought, and I think it's really important we explore, keep all the discussion about all those options alive, because we can do better than the system that we've currently got.
I think most people generally think we've got three levels of government, the federal, state and local government as levels of government. My contention is we only have two constituted levels of government, that's state and federal. Local governments are merely the administrative arms of the state government, and any majority state government at a stroke of a pen can wipe them out and basically send them into, get rid of the councillors, the organisation, and just send state administrators in it to run it. And that's actually in smaller regional areas like Shires or Cloncurry, Richmond and things like that, and Flinders, because the population isn't that great. They do have a local council, but it doesn't have the facilities of that of what other major councils do, like a planning commission and all that, a planning department and this and that and all the other bits that go with it. And they actually have a state government. If you go into these towns, they've actually got a state government office where you go and do all that sort of stuff on through that bureaucracy. The local government hasn't got the facilities or the manpower, or just, I mean, you look at Richmond, I think, it's gone down from a population from years ago of over 5,000. It's now only 882 people. So, and a lot of the other shires aren't that much better. So they're not going to have the ability to have that local government that people expect when they go to Cairns or Townsville or other southeast councils. So that's my take on actual levels of government we got. The interesting thing, one of the projects you were involved in is the constitutional recognition of local government. although the state government constitutions do mention them, but I suggest that doesn't talk about their powers. It's just basically that they're there and how they're going to, you know, sort of structure them and pay for them, sort of thing. There's no defined or delineation of powers. And I think one of the problems for local governments over the years, a lot of responsibility has been the state governments have given them a fair bit of responsibility, but never provide them with the real funding or the authority to do that job. And I mean, in Cairns, a typical thing is like, it's the stupid thing, like the bats in the city. Like the arguments went back and forth between the state government and the local government says, well, the council should be doing it. Then the council basically was hamstrung because it didn't have any authority to deal with the Commonwealth and the overriding legislation of protection of the animals. And so it was just, nothing happened for such a long time. And it just became, you know, it's basically a standoff. And for years we had to put up with the bats. I mean, they've been moved on now. I think that's a problem in regards to a lot of councils have taken on responsibilities, but have not, the authority and the funding hasn't been devolved down to them.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I remain a strong supporter of federal constitutional recognition for local government, because I believe all our levels of government, whether we've got 2, 3 or 4, should all be clear in the one constitutional framework, a bit more like Canada would be better. And so I remain a big fan of that. It's just sort of a fallback to recognise them in state constitutions. And I think that the key is that we need stronger local government. I mean, we've got a very weak local government system compared to most of the countries that we want to compare ourselves to. And so the difficulty is whether we want to keep a small local government system and build up a regional level, or whether we want a strong local government system and somehow get more resources off the state level to make that work. These are actually really serious questions that in the end we're going to have to keep on addressing. So it's really important that people don't just assume that the system is stuck the way that it is, because we can't afford to think that way in the long term. We've got to make sure that the system keeps on evolving.
We've just clocked over the hour, but if you're okay to go for another 10 or 15 minutes, is that okay with you?
Yeah, I'm not going anywhere.
that's good. just talking about recognition of local government, I'll just have a screenshot of a couple of attempts to get constitutional recognition of the local governments. One was in the 70s and one was in the 80s. So I'll just chuck up those two referendum questions and their results. Up on the screen, we've got the 1974 referendum question. And we seem to be not having too many referendums lately, whereas we used to have a reasonable, not that we've had a lot, but when we did, it's quite interesting, they had up to 4 questions or that in the referendums. But the first one is the constitution alteration, local government bodies. 74 sought to give the Commonwealth Parliament powers to borrow money for and make financial assistance grants directly to local government bodies. The proposed law entitled the Act to alter the Constitution to enable the Commonwealth to borrow money for, that repeats the same, do you approve of the proposed law? It was lost in all 4 states, lost in all states with the exception of New South Wales, and only had 47% in favour. In 1988, there was another one. The Australian Constitution recognises government at federal, state levels, but makes no mention of local governments. The Constitution for the local government, 1988, proposes to alter the Constitution so to give to recognise local governments. Now, that is actually the most defeated, worst outcome referendum ever held in the country. it lost in all states and only 33% were in favour. So it doesn't bode well for constitutional recognition of local governments. And I, considering some of the petty things that goes on in our council and goes on in other councils, it probably is not going to get a Guernsey. How do you feel today in regards to what you found out with your exploration of that question in 2012 when you looked into it?
Yeah, no, I mean, when I was a member of the Commonwealth Government's expert panel on exactly this question on constitutional recognition of local government, the view of the panel was that we should proceed with it, but my own view and many of us was that the time wasn't right because the right level of public opinion and understanding about why we need to put local government in the constitution just wasn't there, so it wasn't going to succeed. And you've got to remember that it's easy to derail referenda. In 1988, all of the referenda, there were a number of referendum questions put on different issues. They all failed because the opposition at the time chose to campaign against them and there was no bipartisan support. So they all died. And it was less about local government and more about the fact that it was turned into a partisan political fight. And that's not how you should approach changing the constitution. If there isn't a bipartisan groundswell of support there might be people who disagree and they have to be persuaded. But unless that's there, if it's a divided partisan thing, then it's just not going to happen. Yeah. And nor should it happen.
You can't expect to take the people with you that sort of situation.
Exactly. And this is a reform to the constitution for what we would intend would be a long period of time. So we want people to be confident that we're doing the right thing as a nation. The next big change to the constitution, which is definitely needed, is recognition of Indigenous Australians, of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, and in a meaningful way, not just a symbolic way. The thing about the 1988 constitutional recognition of local government provision as well, the form of recognition that was proposed was also just basically symbolic. It wouldn't have changed anything at all, and that's not a reason to change the constitution. It should have symbolic value and political value, but it should actually be a concrete improvement. And there's actually good reason why putting local government in the constitution so that it can become part of the federal financial system, a more integrated federal financial system, is actually necessary. There's still lots of programs that the Commonwealth government tries to fund where its constitutional authority to shovel the money out the door is not clear. Things like Roads to Recovery, if people remember that, some of the direct grants that go to local government, their constitutional basis is still not clear because the Commonwealth government has limited power to just send money to whoever it wants, and it can certainly grant money to the states, but its powers to grant money directly to local government are not as clear in all cases as we would want them to be. And so there has to be games played, or there's these doubts about constitutionality of some programs. So
I think that was really obvious in the 2019 election with the sports rorts. I think if that was the greatest misuse of funds in regards to buy votes in different electorates and that going, I think there's still a lot of criticism of that. I think it cost Bridget McKenzie her ministerial position in the long run. And I still have problems with the feds seeking to get election bonus on those sort of local programs in regards to, you know, vote for so-and-so on the federal member and I'll get you a sports ground or something or a toilet block, when responsibilities of the Commonwealth, you know, get back to what your job is: defence, immigration, borders, biosecurity and some other factors. And that's what they're the things what you should really be getting elected on, for what you're doing in those fields, not for the fact that you you manage to get a $200,000 grant to the local football club to get them a new change room. That is, I think, that is abuse of power or abuse of funding. So how do you take, what's your take on those sort of things, that level of sort of funding down to there?
I think you're quite right to highlight that sort of issue. That is another example of where the Commonwealth spends money for particular electoral purposes and for, you know, sort of to be seen to be relevant to local communities in ways that are not necessarily actually rational and in the long-term public interest. If the Commonwealth government wanted to more systematically fund the serious infrastructure needs at local and regional levels, then take political credit for that, that would be a much more coherent way to do things. And the key thing is that to do some of that, it would make sense to put local government in the constitution so that the ability of the federal government to, and the states for that matter, to enter into tripartite long-term funding arrangements which are really sustainable and really sustain the community and physical infrastructure that we need would justify a constitutional change to put local government in the constitution. But I think it's important that to recognise that local government also, this sort of brings us full circle, if you like. Local government has to be accountable as well, has to be transparent as well, has to have a high level of integrity, has to be subject to that accountability scrutiny that we started talking about, so that it shows itself to be capable of carrying that higher degree of responsibility, handling more resources, handling more funds than typically it usually does across most of the country at the moment. So it's we've got to choose some of these different options for strengthening the system so that we really do have a system that will continue to stand the test of time. It's not the system isn't falling apart completely at the moment, but there's enough cracks in it to show that it's really worthwhile thinking about how to improve it in ways that strengthen the hand of the community at a local and regional level in terms of political autonomy and also access to resources, but while being part of a more cooperative federal system overall, both those things are actually got to be seriously part of having that longer term, more resilient system of government that we really need and if we work at it, hopefully can have.
The next screen share probably is an indication of the challenges ahead in regards to local government. Oops, where are you? Here's the problem. 535 local councils, and that poses a challenge. And it has become one of the most expensive government administration systems now, with so many CEOs of a lot of councils earning more than the Prime Minister. And you've got administrators like the CEO, this Chief Financial Officer, and other high-powered executives that take a lot of the way administration costs. Whereas before, in the old days, the council were a few councillors on an honorarium. They weren't actually paid that, you know, overly. Now I think the mayors are on about 180,000. I think councillors are on about 108,000 or something like that. So it's become a very expensive sort of government over time. And it does represent a big challenge sort of gathering all those councils up and sort of being able to manage their finances or divvy the finances out amongst that sheer number. And the other problem that we have is both in Queensland and New South Wales, we've had state governments implement amalgamations, and they just aren't that well received. So for local governments to get a Guernsey under the federal system, I don't think we can have 535 of them. It seems just unmanageable, especially when some of the councils are only got maybe 1,000, 2,000 people in them, especially in some of those sparsely populated areas. So do you think part of this thing in regards to recognition of local councils would need to cut that number down to a more manageable number, so you haven't got so many people to pull money out to, and then also you'd have to have the administration then to check that spending the money properly too. So it becomes a bit of a nightmare with having 535 councils.
Yeah, I don't think the number of councils in and of itself is a problem. I mean, not that long ago, we used to have a couple of hundred more than we've got now. And I don't think amalgamations is necessarily the answer. Sometimes it makes sense, and other times it's been pursued for ulterior purposes, really, and based on false economies or expectations. I think the first step to sort of unpick it all is really to have a national strategy that recognises the diversity of local government, but identifies how we can lift the standards across the board, lift them in different ways. And I mean, lift the standards of the system in terms of clarity on responsibilities, access to resources, which should hinge on constitutional recognition, and standard expectations for sort of remuneration and resourcing, and to then pursue that as a national strategy with the support of the states, rather than it being as ad hoc and inconsistent and all over the place as it currently is now. Because until we do that, we won't have a better formula for figuring out how local government can be more effectively resourced to do what the community wants it to do, and to have the flexibility to do that. And the community won't support local government as much as it should, because there are questions about integrity and accountability, and the fact that there are still too many corruption risks on people who work in local government. There's still too many forces that undermine community confidence in local government, even though people actually have more confidence in the performance of local government on average than they necessarily do in the other two levels of government. So we really need a national strategy for thinking about both resourcing and capacity, and also standards and integrity standards, and some mechanisms that are nationally coordinated for basically lifting the whole quality of our local government level. And we have to do that in the context of just there being agreement that that's worthwhile and a necessary step to a better system, even if there's also other options for strengthening the system. And unless we're prepared to take that on seriously, I think then we're almost guaranteed to be sort of kicking around in where we currently are, inevitably. And so I think we have to be able to do better than that.
I think we also have to address the cost of administration in regards to we can't have a situation where we've got, hundreds of CEOs who get more than the Prime Minister. It's completely out of tune with what public expectations are. Is a person who's got an 8-to-5 job, right? He works under a set of conditions that is a box of rules. That's it. You've got a business card. You've got all expenses paid for going on trips and things like that. And you're picking up more than Prime Minister. I mean, I think some of the wages in that administrator field is out of proportion for what community expectations are. And I think probably that maybe need to be addressed, because I think local government has become a very, very expensive level of government over especially the last 15 years. So it's probably something that we probably need to look at as well. Do you think there needs to be more emphasis on those sort of costings and that in regards to local government? Because I don't know what your feeling is, but I sort of object to a local government person who works under a set of well-defined rules and procedures and get $450,000 to $700,000. I think the highest paid one's almost $700,000 a year in Sydney. that's an awful lot of money sort of thing for what the town clerk used to do back in the 50s, 60s and 70s.
Well, I think I don't think we're overspending on local government as a whole. So I think it would be a mistake to say that because there are, you know, excessive administrative costs in some areas, et cetera, or because people are, rorting the system here or there, that means that local government as a whole is rolling in money and wasting it. I think that's far from the case. You know, on average, we're underfunding local government across the board. I think there's no question about that.
But if administration costs is a third of the cost, well, that's a problem that needs to be addressed. You have to obviously.
Yeah. About having an agreed national strategy that means that we know, you know, we set standards like remuneration controls, for example. Like you said, they've got to be rational. And at the moment, the ad hocery means that they're not necessarily always rational. So we need to treat local government as if it is part of our, you know, a key part of our federal system. And to do that, we need to bring it almost like sort of bring it into the thinking of regularising it as part of one coherent national system, while recognising the diversity of the circumstances and the size and the scale of local government that we've got. So it's a big challenge, but I think it's a really vital one, or we're just not going to change the fundamentals of the ball game the way that we need to.
Okay, if we can just move to the last thing on the sort of the agenda, sort of. Working with the constitution we do have, there is a provision there for separate states. Unfortunately, I don't know whether our founding fathers were having a bit of a lend of us, or they actually thought more of the politicians coming after them than what we can expect from the ones we have these days. But they put that chapter 6 there with the intention that there would be a gradual development of more states, especially because they'd been around, they'd basically knew the history of Australia, the additional colonies that had been hived off from New South Wales. I mean, even Tasmania was originally part of the colony of New South Wales. Well, half of Australia and New Zealand was part of New South Wales, the colony of New South Wales, but then it gradually got hived off to New Zealand, obviously went its own way. Tasmania was the first to become a separate colony. South Australia, in Victoria, and then finally Queensland in 1859. West Australia, on the other hand, was a separate colony altogether. It wasn't even under the first sign. It was basically still called New Holland, and it wasn't until I think there was a threat of pending invasion, or they thought invasion from the French, that they actually sent military people to Albany, and then eventually they sent the first settlers to Perth in 1829 and founded the colony there. So the founding fathers were well aware how Australia developed over that time, and of course they expected to keep changing, and especially with the situation that had evolved in central and north Queensland, there was an expectation that would probably happen. That hasn't come about, but the provisions are still there. And unfortunately, when they wrote chapter six, they put the power of creating a separate state completely in the hands of the relevant state parliament. So it requires the state parliament to agree. Now, obviously, from our examples in the 1920s and 30s in New South Wales, there was an indication that there was an appetite to create additional states, but the timing was wrong with the Great Depression and the World War II. But now we've really gone into the two-party system, and it's definitely not something with the two-party, either of the two major parties are interested in. And as I said before, the only way you can do it is where there's a bounce of power situation by a minor party that pushes it and gets it over the line as far as a referendum. Now, when Jason spoke about it, his position was another state can't afford it. You know, how would you ever manage? And so that I think it's a lot of it. It's the same attitude with a lot of people in the southeast. Well, we couldn't survive without Brisbane, you know, giving us a hand, but whatever. So what sort of mindset needs to happen to sort of get politicians or get some interest back into separate states? And that's a way of also giving us more localised government, you could say, because admittedly a North Queensland state would be fairly big in the first instance, but maybe later on it would get hived down into Central and North Queensland. And then in New South Wales, there's probably about three areas you could recognise as separate states. So how do we get over this impasse with the parliament? Do we just keep bashing our heads to find minority parties to push the issue? Or do you think there's a way to convince the major parties that it's benefit for the nation to have additional states?
Well, I think it relies on us developing a bit of a consensus rather than expecting somehow or other that a particular region can just secede, or even for that matter, I mean, if the constitution had been written slightly differently, then it would be easier to see how the federal government might decide as part of a national strategy, it would be better that there be more states and initiate referenda that would then make it harder for the existing states to resist a carve-up. But I guess the carve-up has to be rational and has to be supported by a consensus. So I think you hit the nail on the head by saying there's got to be a better understanding of why it would be in the national benefit. And so that really requires rethinking quite a bit of the constitution, because the whole system's got to work more cooperatively. It's not like a state of North Queensland or a state of the Kimberley is going to be an island in and of itself. It's not like it's going to secede from the country. It's still got to be part of the country. It's still going to have to have a cooperative relationship with the states next door. There needs to be a clear understanding of the financial benefits, so that, you know, things like mining royalties are lost to the existing government. It's got to be clear that, and people have got to have confidence that those resources are going to be still well used for the regional and national benefit. So when you think about it that way, you think, my God, there's sort of such huge barriers to change. But I think we have to recognise that the whole world is changing, and that it makes sense to try and create a process and environment where we sit down and go, hey, how could we run this a lot better? I mean, it was in 2016 or 2014, 15, 16, the Abbott government pursued a process of trying to look at how to make the Federation work better, which would have been a good stepping stone towards saying, right, if we can make the whole system work better, then we can rethink who the players are in the game. Yeah, and I noticed that Tony Abbott was saying that as coming out of COVID, we should have a serious review of the state of the Federation as well and how it's handled these things. And I think that what we really need to do as the next step is not only think about what we're going to do with local government, like we've been talking about, because those issues won't go away, is think seriously about, okay, if we want to learn all the lessons from all of this, then what roles and responsibilities are better off managed from a regional level, if you like, the level of what a new state might be, and then how is that going to be supported? And then I think that's the step towards saying, well, would it look like a territory? Would it look like a state? What would it look like? But we need a concept that's a consensus concept of stronger regional level government. You know, what was originally a colony, now we've subsequently turned into a whole lot of states. Tasmania is still very small state. And if you replicated Tasmania as a sort of a model of states all around the country, you'd have a lot of states. So I think we need to have a conversation that enables us to try and get a clearer picture of that sort of consensus.
I think the issue is really we've had people freak on about a North Queensland state in particular, but they've never really defined a criteria in that, especially, the Katters are the people who have barked up at the a number of times, but they really don't have a set of criteria. George Christensen's supported the idea verbally, both in the state conferences, along with Matt Canavan, and also George has stood up in Parliament and spoken about a separate North Queensland state. The general thing that we get back from people in the southeast, like Jason, and there's people like Paul Williams and that, say, well, we have a good deal with what we've got because the pro rata monies you get from the state is good and that, even though, we're paying a lot of the royalties come from us. But the thing is, people who look into it do have some understanding what the requirements are. We're not just a bunch of dills who just emotionally think, oh, well, parochialism, this is our area and we should be a separate state. I mean, I come from West Australia. I've never had anything to do with Queensland until I came here in 2012. But the most obvious thing when I first got here was the constant whinging of local people in regards to getting a raw deal from Brisbane, whether it's financial, the legislation that coming out of it's irrelevant or it's harmful. We've had things like the Vegetation Management Act, where Brisbane and people down there in concrete jungle make decisions on whether we should cut or clear regrowth areas and that. And there's the impingement on agriculture in regards to using the reef as a cover to sort of cripple a lot of industry, agricultural industry. So what's coming out of there doesn't fit us, and in actual fact is anti-development for the regions. And I think the regions have the most potential to grow the pie in Australia coming out of COVID. And it's important that money that's going to come out invested in the regions to actually have growth and development rather than just fund new housing or give people extra $25,000 for a housing grant, which the end result is you just get a house and it just costs you $25,000 more to get built, which was basically came out of the GFC situation. You couldn't get a contractor for love and money. The price of building materials went up. So by the end of the day, you might have got an extra about $30,000 or $32,000 grant, but your house cost you an extra $40,000. So it wasn't that much benefit into it. So in regards to a separate state of North Queensland, we do have a bit of an idea in regards to what its criteria should be. And the other thing, it's not about the money. It's not about this fair share. Where we started off from was in 2016-17, when there was the redistribution. And what happened is you got four extra seats in the Brisbane Parliament. And so we went to a 93-seat Parliament, and Central and North Queensland had its 17 seats. If it wasn't for the Katters, that redistribution would have resulted in no increase in the number of seats in Parliament. It would have been kept at 89, and Central and North Queensland would have lost two seats. Now, that's what our argument in regards to a separate state is. It's about representation, not money, not just the sheer money of it. It's the fact that we can make decisions and the best decisions in our interest with our own Parliament. So you just dropped out for a bit there. So that's the focus we'd rather look at in regards to representation, and then making our own decisions, being responsible for our own revenue raising. Of course, you always got to have the redistribution of funds from the Commonwealth. And so as long as we're not a mendicant state like Tasmania, Tasmania is an absolute basket case. I mean, they get 70 cents in the dollar comes from the Commonwealth. They've actually got hardly any ability to raise their own revenue. And that's one's the thing you don't want to do when you're creating new states, is have states that sort of can't carry their own weight. So if I can just show you a few figures in regards to what a North Queensland state, because this is one of the things that Jason was going about, that we couldn't carry ourselves. But I think these figures should sort of give people an indication that we can carry it. And the thing is, what we're really on about is representation. And I think that's one of the most important things in regards to our constitutional right, is our right to representation. And it's basically in the region that's been eroded and continues to be eroded, because at the moment, in the last 4 years, the population increase in Southeast has gone up by 312,000, according to the ABS, and in regions it's only gone up 18,000. So when you break that down to future redistributions and voting patterns, we're going to be in dire straits come the next redistribution in 24. We'll be lucky to hold on to all the seats we currently have. And do you think that's a good part of the argument as well, rather than just sort of the funding and those sort of things in regards to a state, the actual representation of the people in the regions?
Well, I mean, it's representation for what purpose, I guess, is the key thing. It's the decision making centralization that you talked about initially that's really the issue there, not how many seats you've got in the parliament. It's the fact that there needs to be a more regional control over certain areas of policy, which isn't happening, you know, with the current political geography that we've got. So I mean, in terms of financial terms, Every state and territory is going to be part of a federal financial system and is not going to be totally independent. And it's not a question of being able to balance your books completely. It's the country that's got to try and balance its books. And we've got to recognise that the costs of having effective government at regional level will sometimes, you know, they won't be self-sustaining on traditional terms, like the Northern Territory isn't, or, you know, every single jurisdiction is at a different point on the spectrum when it comes to the relativities of horizontal fiscal equalization, as we call it, within the Federation. And Western Australia is making a lot of money for the rest of the country at the moment. I think it's more, I mean, it's interesting with some of the policy issues you mentioned, then when it comes to like sustainability policy, for example, sustainable agriculture and development, protecting biodiversity, those things aren't necessarily going to, they require national strategies. And if the decisions on those things weren't being made at a state level, then they would be made at a national level more for some of those things. And that's appropriate. But what is important is that regional communities have a stronger ability to play their part in that decision making and look for solutions. If it's industry development solutions, alternatives, you know, what are we going to do as we phase out coal mining, for example, which is going to happen. So it's more regional communities having control and resources to actually map a future rather than trying to fight a rear guard action against change that is basically going to come one way or another.
I take exception to some things there in regards to what the state government has done. The state government basically is treating our farmers like vandals in regards to the Vegetation Management Act and the reef. No farmer is a vandal. They want to preserve their land. They want to be able to keep farming for generations and generations. You've got a system now. I mean, the Vegetation Management Act, Now, they did a consultation process, went to about 20 regional towns, all these public submissions. There were 722 public submissions from farmers and organisations and other members of even the South, you know, there would have been Greens and that environmentalists as well. But not one word of that act got changed. And that, to me, is just an act of bastardry, because they didn't take into account, and they basically are saying all people in the regions cannot manage their own affairs and can't sustainably manage their land. And now you've got a situation which is abhorrent. It's now you've got a state government, you've got a Minister of Environment whose first term in the Parliament is the Minister of Environment. I don't know, and so I don't want to comment on her abilities of that, but her chief of staff is a guy called Nick Heath. Now, he comes from the World Wildlife Management the Marine Conservation or Society or Australian Conservation. That's his history. He's been an activist all that time. Now he's sitting in that department. Do you think people in regional Queensland are going to get a fair go in regards to legislation that's going to come out of that area when they got that much bias? So that's one of the sort of things we're looking at in regards to if we're looking after our own, had our own parliament, we'd deal with that thing in our own way. And we're not vandals. We can manage those things. So, but we're probably a bit fairer than what they are, thinking that we can actually look after it. So they're the things that we're sort of looking at as well.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think the capacity to forge solutions to these problems and these issues, building that capacity at a regional level is part of what needs to occur. So it doesn't mean that it's not going to need to be a solution that meets the interests and the needs of a community which is larger than the region itself. There's no such thing as total autonomy in this day and age. But there has to be a better formula for there to be the resources and the capacity within the region to have a much greater degree of control over mapping out and then prosecuting solutions that will work. And I think it pays to think back to the Federation period. For example, when at the time that Samuel Griffith, who Griffith University is named after, was sort of helping draft the original constitution, and he supported the drafting that took it in a direction that said that Queensland would enter the Federation as three states, provided, but only if they entered the Federation. So one of the things that he was most concerned about was ending blackbirding, ending the use of imported Pacific Islander labour in the agricultural industry in North Queensland. Because he was really worried, as were a lot of people, about basically the development of effectively a slave-based or something very close to it, a racially-based slave economy in North Queensland. Now, that, I think you can look back at that and say, well, it was quite a good idea. I mean, it was, you can argue about how blackbirding was phased out and how Kanaka labour was phased out, for example, but you would look back and say, well, it was a good idea to have that perspective that said that's we didn't want regions of Australia developing in that way, but that's the price of being that would have been the price of being an independent state within a federation, where the federation as a whole didn't allow that kind of basis for labour and immigration. So I think we have to recognise that no one. You know, even if we have a system, and I believe that a system that had stronger regional autonomy and capacity would be a much better system, it's still going to have to be a system that works as part of a cooperative national approach, whether these things are being controlled from Brisbane or being controlled from Canberra, from the national parliament. And there's no way around that. So people have to think big about the options and what it would take to come up with a better system, in my humble opinion.
just finish up on the separate state issue and that before we wind up. I'll just show a screenshot. This is an indication of comparison of economies. It's only ever dealt with actual budgets and finances rather than the forecast ones and that. So the last one before COVID, before Queensland had a, I mean, Queensland did eventually have a 2020 budget, but it didn't come in too late. So these figures are actually on the 17-18 actual spending and that. And if you look at the comparisons between South Australia, Tasmania, and what would be a central and North Queensland state, total revenue for South Australia is only $16 billion. And this total revenue for Tasmania is only $5.5 billion, which is small dogs, really. And if you look at Queensland, its actual revenue is around about the $40 billion. Although some people get confused, even the economists, though, well, they say, well, there was $60 billion in the budget. But a lot of that $20 billion extra in the budget is actually Commonwealth money that's been assigned to the government in regards to spending on projects like, you know, where the Commonwealth's paying 80% of the Bruce Highway or 80% of this other product. So the budget figures sometimes distort the actual capability of the state to raise revenue. And you can quite see, we've worked out using our local economist up here in Cairns, we would probably generate a revenue of around about $13 billion for about less than a million people, which compared to the $16 billion of South Australia, is comparable. So we can run ourselves and not be a real drag on the Commonwealth. We'll just get our normal share. And that's $1.14 for GST redistribution is fairly conservative, because I think over history Queensland's been about $1.09, but most of that money has been there, you know, there's been about $1 million extra thrown into the kitty for regional delivery of service to regional areas. So I think financially we've got it covered. But here's another interesting run in comparison in between North Queensland and Central Queensland state in population comparisons. We'd be closing the gap on a million people. Now that's one of the interesting things. When we talked to Bernard Salt, leading demographer, he actually suggested you need roughly about a million people to have a viable state in regards to the delivery of services and revenue base and that you need these days. Because if you go back into colonial days, the colonial government didn't actually deliver away much as in regards to services and that. But state governments now are charged with the responsibility to deliver a lot of services. The other thing is the comparison between gross domestic product or gross state product. And North Queensland and Central Queensland would have a GSP of about $63 billion. South Australia's is about $106 billion, which is roughly equal to, well, they're 1.7 million people rather than a million people. And the GSP for Tasmania is about $30 billion. But when it comes to the value we deliver for the Commonwealth and for the nation, Central and North Queensland has a value of merchandising sea exports of $60 billion. Now, the whole of Queensland's exports, sea exports, they're only around about the $85, $89 million. So we're punching above our weight. And then if you look at South Australia, there are only $12 billion of exports and Tasmania, $4 billion. So I think we can hold our own in that sort of area. So from where we come, Brisbane, is we have got the basic criteria. We need made sure we want a state that's got a, you know, close to 1 million people as possible. The revenue base, just on comparison with at least South Australia, and basically we've got the resources to carry forward, and we've definitely got the potential for grow the pie for the nation if we're given the opportunity. But we're never going to get that opportunity from Brisbane. Brisbane is not really leading the way with the infrastructure like dams or roads that have improved economic advancement. So unless we can throw off those shackles, or Brisbane state government starts to realise, well, we've got to grow the pie, and the people who can grow the pie with in the future is the region, so the investment in there. But I'd much rather we do it ourselves. The other thing is, like I was talking about with representation, there's 530,000 people in Tasmania. Got their own bicameral parliament, 25 members of the lower house, 15 members of their upper house. They've got 12 senators, and they've got 5 members guaranteed to them for the lower house, although the current population quota for a federal seat is about 175,000 people of population. That's not voters, it's different. Basically, on that quota figure, Tasmania should only have about two and a half members of parliament, federal parliament. But as a founding member of the state of the federation, they were guaranteed 5, just as Western Australia was guaranteed at least 5. So that's something we have to live with. So do you think it's reasonable? I'll just try to finish up on this question. Do you think it's reasonable that 1 million people in central and north Queensland, A, capable of running their own state, and B, are worthy of the same representation for Tasmania? Or do you think there should be a real objection to that?
No, I think there's no question that however you carved up Queensland into 2 or 3 or 4, even more states than that you could do that in a way that would create a really, you know, really viable, strong, super regional governments, if you like, that could do an incredibly effective job on behalf of their communities and be really strong participants in the federation. The same could be said of New South Wales still, and the same could be said to some degree in other parts of the country, although you might want to look more at an arrangement where you had more territories as well as more states in different parts of the country. I think, you know, from a theoretical point of view and a practical point of view, I don't think that's a problem. And it's, I guess, the question of how that flows out in terms of Senate representation and all those sorts of things, I guess I would come back to it being not something that it's going to be solved by viewing ourselves or yourselves as being under the shackles of Brisbane or under the shackles of anybody else, because I don't think that's really the issue. I think that really the issue is what's effective, what's going to be an effective framework of government for the regions in terms of what services should government be delivering, what resources and industries need to be invested in, and how they should be controlled, and then what's the structure of government that's going to best support that and give communities the capacity to forge their own solutions to problems, whether it's running public health or whether it's other things. And I think there's enough evidence that we can do better than we're currently doing. I don't think that the current state of the nation is in such, you know, that it's falling apart to the extent to which we're in a crisis, but I don't think that should stop us looking seriously at how we can do better. And I think some structural reform of the system is going to is going to be part of that, in probably still within a federal structure. So I think it's really important.
We'll definitely stay in a federal structure. That's fine, and we've got and work within the Constitution. I mean, the Constitution provides us with a mechanism anyway to smaller entities, but it's just not being used. And I think there's a common, because now we're speaking to people in New South Wales from the Riverina State Party, from the Fishers and Shooters and things like that. And there is a general feeling out there in the regions that, well, the legislation coming out of Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane is anti-development. It's against more farming. It's definitely against forestry. It seems to be legislation that's definitely not fitting the needs of regional Australia and the development of regional Australia and the growth of regional Australia. If anything, it does tend to be viewed by a lot of people in the regions that it's counterproductive to our growth, and it's a vision of what people in the cities have of the regions, that they don't actually, they never lived here. Even the people who make the policies in regards to vegetation management, they've probably never been up to the Cape and seen the regrowth problems. They've never been to the mulga bushes areas and seen where the growth of those things have overtaken. Not all growth, vegetation growth, is helpful. So there seems to be this perception by people in the inner city and the people who are lobbying there in those areas that, you know, everything has to be done to protect nature, and humans don't figure into the equation. And the thing is, we're humans in the region, and we're getting a little bit angry in regards to some of the legislation that's coming out. So I think that's got to be the driving force in the long term. And I think we just need to sort of keep pushing on in regards to using the Constitution to somehow find a way through this. But it would be much better if the state governments, and especially the parliaments of Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane, at least looked at the idea of saying, well, maybe they are so far away, they do have a different set of criteria, and maybe they can manage themselves better, and they don't actually need to be nursemaid or controlled by us anymore, because we've grown up, we've actually got big boy pants on now.
Well, I think the answer partly lies in creating a consensus as to how this alternative system or these changes would actually benefit everybody. So I think that's the only way that you'll shift policymakers from other regions, and at a national level, if there's that some kind of consensus constructed in that direction. So I guess I can understand why it's a big driver of people's concerns to feel that they're alienated or not being listened to, or that the policies aren't a good fit for the region. And sometimes that will be true. But in terms of actually a path to reform, that's only part of the equation. Unless we can work together to construct a positive vision of something that's going to be better for everybody, then you're unlikely to move enough opinion across the board in the direction of that solution. So I guess that's part of the political challenge for those of us who consider
that. There's a political conundrum, but hopefully out of this pandemic, the essential need to actually grow the pie is going to be so overwhelming that they need to look at big projects, big infrastructure spends in the regions to grow that pie. And there's projects like Iron Boomerang, projects that get us more water. I mean, this situation where people keep concentrating on, you shower, mud, your water use down, drink sewage, recycle sewage. Where's the vision in regards to getting more water supplied into the system, And hopefully it will have to be that vision, so we can grow the pie to come out of this pandemic and the debt that we've built up. So that's one hope that will dawn on the Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane politicians, the regions have got to be in this mix in regards to going forward, and not just getting the Olympic Games in Brisbane is going to be a solvable thing. That's good infrastructure for you, but it doesn't build wealth of the country outside, or those sort of things, which we're going to desperately need as we go ahead. Anyway, would you like to finish up on anything in particular? Because we've gone a long way from integrity of government, levels of government, to regional people bitching about people in southeast Queensland and in Sydney, Melbourne.
Well, I think I'd just conclude, Bill, by saying it's been a really stimulating conversation, and good luck to us all.
Right. Thanks very much for your time. Maybe in a month or a couple of months from now, I can round up Jason Murphy or something, and do another bit of a show like that. Concentrate a little bit more on it and get the economic side as well. But look, I really appreciate your time tonight. I hope you had an early tea and all those sort of things. But again, thanks very much for coming on the show. It was really appreciated. We'll just wind up now, but if you just stay on the line, we'll just have a little talk after the thing. Andrew, you haven't gone to sleep, have you? Andrew,
he might have gone to sleep. I'll just wind up.
You might have to edit this a little bit. Thank you for joining tonight's episode. If you like the show, please like, share, and subscribe to the Facebook pages, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Next week, we're negotiating with a couple of parties. One will either be the party in regards to looking at the Karanda Range crossing to connect Cairns and the Tablelands more effectively than the current Karanda Range road. And we'll need about $2 billion from Brisbane or the Commonwealth to help us with that. Or we'll be talking to members of the Fishers and Shooters Party in New South Wales. Thanks very much, and we'll join us again next week.